Welcome to church today. So glad that you are here. Why don't you turn around and say hi to three or four or five people around you? Glad to have you all watching at home today. Can you believe it that next Sunday is Palm Sunday and this wonderful choir and this wonderful director will be presenting the cantata next Sunday, and then the Sunday after that is Easter Sunday. So I mean, it can't get cold anymore, right? Okay, let's have a word of prayer. We'll begin. Father, we love you. We praise you. We thank you for this day. This is the day that you have made, and we're going to rejoice and be glad in it. And we want to worship you today in your precious name. Amen. Amen. Like I said, a lot of things coming up. Here's what's happening at Kimberling City Methodist Church. Welcome to church today. We're so glad you're here with us here at Kimberling City Methodist Church. And we want to invite you to be a part of any of our three distinct worship services that we have each and every Sunday. We have something for everybody. We'd love to have you try out any of our three distinct worship services each and every Sunday here at Kimberling City Methodist Church.
Our church choir will be presenting a cantata this year entitled, Love Took His Breath Away. We are doing this on Palm Sunday morning at the 9:15 service. We invite everyone to come and take part in this beautiful production. During Passion Week, we will have a special service on Maundy Thursday, celebrating communion and the last day of Jesus before he went to the cross on Friday. We would love to have you come. It's at 7:00 in the evening, and it will be a beautiful service.
Well, it's almost time for Resurrection Sunday. Easter Sunday will be coming April 9th, not too far away. We will have four services here at Kimberling City Methodist Church, starting with our outdoor sunrise service at 6:45 a.m., followed by our front porch gospel Easter celebration at 8 a.m., and then we'll have our traditional Easter worship service at 9:15 a.m., followed by our Connect contemporary service at 10:30 a.m. You don't want to miss this. Sunday, April 9th, four services, Easter Sunday, invite a friend. Good morning. I'd like to begin with a very important date for you to put on your pocket calendars, your smartphones, and the refrigerator calendar. And that date is April the 13th, that's a Thursday, April the 13th, Thursday at 6 p.m., Pregnancy Lifeline, also known as PLL, will be hosting its annual fundraising banquet. You are certainly invited to this banquet. It is going to take place at First Baptist Church, Kimberling City. The good news is that several churches in the area are hosting what's known as watch parties. At these watch parties, the program occurring at First Baptist Church will be live streamed. In addition, the same food that's being served at First Baptist will be served at these churches. To find out what churches you need to contact, simply get in touch with me, and I will give you the names of the churches, and you can contact them and let them know so that they can register you. You need to do this before March the 30th. March the 30th is the date.
Would you stand and let's sing together Wonderful Words of Life.
Yeah. As we go before the Lord in prayer this morning, there are many in our church and many around that are counting on us to pray. I want you to think of one specific person, one specific need that you can pray for today as we lift up our brothers and sisters in Christ. Father, we thank you and praise you that we can be in your house. We thank you that we can come before your throne. And you said that we are to bring our petitions before you. And Father, we have friends, we have family, we have people that we love that need a touch from you. And we just pray that this day, even at this hour, that they would feel your touch, Father, that they would know that you are there, that they would feel your presence. And we thank you for this. In your precious name, amen and amen. And would you please recite the Apostles' Creed with me today? I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the holy universal church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen.
How many of you, when you think of the cross, think that it's beautiful? Not very many of us, I don't think. There's a beautiful, terrible cross where, though you committed no sin, Savior, you suffered the most wicked fate on the cruelest creation of man. Yet, on that beautiful, terrible cross, you did what only you could, turning that dark-inspired evil of hell into our world's greatest good. I would request that you not applaud after the song. If it touches you, please say amen.
Sovereign Lord, still in control, as your perfect plan And we're coming right up on our Palm Sunday when we will hear that entire cantata. Thank you for our choir and everyone. We're going to continue with the series we had started, simply called Something More. And let me repeat myself or just review on the whole premise of what this series is about. The underlying idea with this is simply that each believer, each follower of Christ, is personally responsible for their own spiritual growth. And if we're missing out on the closer relationship we can have with God, the more meaningful spiritual life this side of heaven, then we can take some steps to begin growing spiritually and to engage more deeply in our spiritual walk. And notice, no one can do that for you. The church can help you, and the pastor can help you by providing you some inspiration, some ideas, resources, and equip you to help build your own spiritual toolbox so that you can help yourself grow spiritually. But ultimately, it comes down to, if you want a closer walk and relationship with God, you've got to put some work into that relationship and make a few shifts and changes in our patterns that help to bring that about. So nobody can grow for you spiritually. The family member can't, pastor can't, the church can't. There is no ceremony that can make you closer to God or more mature spiritually, or that can cause your relationship with God to be better. How many of you have been to a very elaborate, expensive wedding? Beautiful ceremony. You've seen those, right? I would also say this, that's nice. However, the elegance or extravagance of the ceremony has no bearing whatsoever on the quality of the relationship that follows. A beautiful wedding ceremony doesn't equal a great marriage. Any ceremony that we might try to engage in will not equal a better relationship with God. Just like in a marriage or family situation, the improved relationship, the quality of relationship there is more contingent upon the attitude, thoughts, and behavior of the people in that relationship than on the extravagance of the ceremony that initiates it. You understand that? Just like with our spiritual walk, we might think, well, I'll grow spiritually if I go and we do a certain ceremony or ritual at church. Probably not. It's going to go back to each of us and how we think and what our attitude is toward God and how we prioritize that and how we're willing to discipline ourselves to be in a state of spiritual growth. So that's what I want to talk about today. And I'm zeroing in today on what we think, how our thoughts are directly connected to how our relationship with God is growing, or how we're growing spiritually. You see, the Bible says that we can be transformed by the renewing of our mind. Romans chapter 12, verse 2, it says, don't be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. The very idea with that is that we come into the relationship with God with lots of thinking that is based on worldly values rather than the values that God wants us to have. And the only way to change that is to have our mind renewed. And therefore, we're transformed. The Holy Spirit helps us with that. And it changes the pattern of how we think about ourselves, the world around us, about others, and about God. And so we definitely can be transformed by the renewing of our mind. And that's what we're going to get into. I like the quote from Albert Einstein when he said, the world we have created is a product of our thinking. It cannot be changed without changing our thinking. Some might take issue that Einstein mentions the world that we created because God created it. What he's really getting at is this. The way you perceive your world makes it your world, and you have a creative role in that. So many of the things are going on around us and in our world, the meaning they have is a meaning that we assign them. And there are so many things that we could assign a different meaning and completely shift our outlook, couldn't we? And that sounds easy, but it's much easier said than done. Look at the scripture in Philippians chapter 4, verse 8, that describes how this renewing of our mind and transformation would look in our lives. It says, "Finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of good report, if there be any virtue, and if there be any praise, think on these things." And we have this entire list of virtuous ideas, of moral valued type of thinking. And Paul, inspired by the Holy Spirit, is writing this and saying, this is the way to redirect your thoughts. This is the way to retrain the way you think to change your spiritual condition. It sounds pretty powerful, because it is. Again, it sounds easy. All you've got to do is change your thinking, change your life, and change the world by doing so. Till you try it, then you realize, well, what I'm trying not to think about is what I keep thinking about. What I really want to think about, I keep getting distracted from. Why is this so difficult? You see, we tend to rehash the same junky old ideas again and again and again, every day and every night. We've got a well-worn path to every one of those not-so-good ideas. There's a neuropsychologist by the name of Rick Hansen. He's the founder of the Wellspring Institute. He says, according to his studies and observation, that we are wired from the start with a negative bias. Our default setting is to go negative. Interesting, isn't it? He said, our minds naturally focus on the bad and discard the good. In fact, he describes the brain as Velcro for negative experiences, Teflon for positive experiences. Everything negative just sticks forever, but the positive just slips right off and never sticks. It does seem that way, doesn't it? You see, we don't have to stay that way. We don't have to. Even though we're hardwired with this negative bias, a default setting that takes us that direction, we don't have to stay that way. Character and discipline and intentional directing of our thoughts will turn this around for us. And that's what today's conversation is really all about. Negative thinking isn't good for us, and yet it's our default setting. How do we flip out of that default setting and do something different, anything different, right? It's a good change. You know what a placebo is, right? What's usually in a placebo? I know everybody says sugar. I don't know why everybody thinks sugar is such a great thing, but we'll go with sugars. They put a sugar pill out, label it whatever you want it to be, tell you it's going to help cure something. And if you really believe that, there's a better chance that it actually will make you feel a little better or whatever. That works with a good percentage of the population. That sort of thing's never worked with me. It either works or it doesn't, you know. But there's also those in clinical research who've developed another idea, and they call it the nocebo effect. And that is, people who have very negative expectations about their treatment in the medical field are more likely to experience negative outcomes. Once again, the way we think about and the way we perceive our experiences, others, God, the world around us, the way we think about all of that directly affects the quality of experience we have in engaging the world around us, the other people in our family, in our closer circles, people in general, and our relationship with God. If we think everybody's out to get us, we're probably not going to make many friends. If we think that God hates you and is just waiting for a chance to smash you really good, you're probably not going to have a very quality relationship with God. You start to get the idea, right? But how do we go ahead and make a shift, just as those scriptures were saying, be transformed by the renewing of our minds? It's great in theory and easier said than done, obviously. So what are some things that help us to make that kind of shift? And I would say, as we've started out the conversation in the previous weeks, faith comes by hearing, hearing by the word of God. Therefore, getting more scripture into our thoughts and into our lives is going to be the first positive, isn't it? But so far as beyond that, what we can do, here's a couple of thoughts I think that will help. First one is this: declare some thoughts just off limits. There are certain thoughts that we can just say, nope, I'm not going there. I already know that is not healthy, that is self-destructive, it's harmful to others. And so that particular direction of thinking, I'm just going to reject and say no to that. And you can probably think of some areas in your own thought life and your own processing of things that you know are not helpful. And you can make those off limits. You see, thinking the wrong way about other people is really going to just wreak havoc in your spiritual life. If you're constantly going through life thinking you need to get even with somebody, that everybody is wronging you, and that there should be better justice for all of that, you're going to have a pretty negative experience in relationships. If we continue through life like that, we'll never be transformed in the renewing of our minds, and we won't have that better quality walk with God. And so we've got to get some of this out of our system, declare some things off limits. If we find that we are just naturally picking on the negative traits in somebody else's life and dwelling on that and focusing on it, well, we'll find that we won't like them very much. Just for an idea of how difficult it is to choose not to think about something or to think about something else, what if I were to tell you for the next 5 minutes, nobody think about a carrot? Okay, don't. No, you don't. Don't think carrots at all. Okay, now, 30 seconds ago, you weren't thinking anything about a carrot. And now you're trying not to think about it, and what's happening? You see how this works? You're doomed. You can't do this, right? It's impossible. But what if I were to give you some nice Brussels sprouts? Probably wouldn't, since you're already trying not to think about carrot. But the best route on this is to redirect our thinking. When a certain pattern comes to mind and we recognize that old familiar pattern, because this is how it works. We have pathways in our brain, okay? Well-worn paths that certain things prompt us, and our minds instantly go to a well-worn, very familiar path, and we recognize all the landmarks along the way, and we know where it goes. And it's usually negative, isn't it? And something hits the trigger on that again, and it prompts that. Same landmarks, same path, same outcome, right? Again and again. We recognize the first landmark or the trigger of that, so what do we do? Here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to say there's something else I can think of right now. I'm going to go back to the list there in Philippians chapter 4, verse 8, and start picking out these things and turning my thoughts towards that, to things that are pure, to things that are lovely, things that are just, things that are of good report, things that are true and honest. And I'm going to turn my thoughts to those kind of things instead. You see, we don't have to dwell on every thought that comes into our mind. We can make some thoughts off limits. And the best way to do that is to have already in mind a different pathway of thinking to redirect every time the trigger comes up on those negative directions. But we can also create a list. That's something else we could do, isn't it? You mean a list of things to think about? You've got to think about something anyway, right? Why not make it productive thinking and helpful thinking? And as we talked about the last couple of weeks, you probably have critics in your life. People are always willing to point out your mistakes, your flaws, or the parts of your character that aren't quite what they should be, or the way you look, or anything like that. But you probably have critics who are more than willing to point those things out to you again and again and again when you're already beating up yourself anyway. You don't need another critic. Besides, how hard is it to be a critic of other people? As we discussed, requires no training. Although some people really developed it into an art. But it requires no training. It really takes no personal discipline. It really takes no character. It doesn't even take practice. Anybody can be a critic, because that's the default setting of how our mind works, isn't it? We switch that, though, and you become that one in a million who, when everybody else is prone to criticize, you pick out the positive, you pick out what is good and focus on that and try to point everybody else toward that instead of all the flaws that everybody else is picking on. And you start to find that you like other people a lot better when you're looking at what's good in their lives rather than what's bad. You'll like yourself a lot better when you can pick out your good qualities and focus on those too. And you start to discover that God loves you a lot more than you ever dreamed. And your relationship with God will improve because of that. And what I'm simply saying is, when you start down this road, it's a step to align your thinking with God's thinking. And as you do that, you will start getting spiritual insights you haven't had before. As you do that, you will start crossing paths with people that God intends for you to cross paths with, because you're aligned with God and you're on the path of discovering all of these things. You're on the right road, and that's where we need to get. So create this list. This will help you too. What list? Well, how about this? I will challenge myself to remember 3 times God has answered my prayers. When I'm down, I'm discouraged, when I can't seem to find my way, when it seems like God is distant from me, so I'll just stop and name 3 times God answered a prayer. And it's saying that about me, but that's for any of us. Make a list of some things like this. Think about the most fun our family has had together. Think about a fun family event when everybody was gathered and you were laughing, you were having a great time, and sort of relive that in your mind. You'll find that's a very healthy thing to do. You'll appreciate your family a lot more, you'll appreciate those memories a lot more, and you'll want to create more of those kind of things. Or you can think about how much you, or all the reasons you love your wife or your husband. That's a good one, isn't it? Just start naming the reasons. Or think about the best qualities in some of your closest friends. Just name some of your friends and start picking out the good character qualities in them or the things they've done that you really appreciate or respect. And you'll find out that you've got another default setting that is not all negative, and you can turn your path away from all the negative thoughts that are dragging you down spiritually and open up a pathway where God is directing you. You're making new spiritual discoveries. You're crossing paths with people that God has set you there in order to either be a help or an encourager for, because you've aligned your thinking with God's thinking now. But let me just get to our takeaway on that, which kind of just reinforces this. One of the things I believe you could take away is simply this, the quote from Henry David Thoreau, who said, "A single footstep will not make a path on the earth. So a single thought will not make a pathway in the mind." Now, you got to repeat it over and over. Unfortunately, we've already got some pretty negative pathways that have become so familiar to us and so active in our minds. To make a deep physical path, we walk again and again. To make a deep mental path, we must think over and over the kind of thoughts that we wish to be dominating in our lives. Again, we've already, most of us, set those patterns up with some negative directions. We have guidance from Scripture here to be transformed by the renewing of our minds, by making new pathways of thought there that take us straight in our relationship with God, that it's going to improve the quality of your walk with God simply because you're aligning the way you think with how God created you to think. And finally, when you change your thoughts, you turn your life right side up and you move in the right direction. As I said, you're now aligning yourself with God's thinking, and God has so much there for you as soon as you put yourself in that place. And it's not a one-time thing. We have to continually be disciplining ourselves and shifting our thoughts toward the direction God wants us to move. And that's where we discover all the great spiritual growth. That's where we find God opening up new opportunities in our lives. Let me ask you to pray with me, okay? Okay.